on the first item of business before us is apologies for absence. I have apologies from Councillor Tracy Timberwood and Councillor John Hale. Are there any other apologies?
I need to read.
Any others? No, thank you. The second item before us tonight is declarations of interest. Councillors, you're asked to consider whether you have any disclosable pecuniary and or any other relevant interest in connection with any matters to be determined at this meeting, and if so, to declare and to state the nature of such interest. I will also remind members, as this is Budget Council, that Section 106 of the Local Government Finance Act 1992 applies to this meeting, so that if a member present is 2 months or more in arrears with their council tax, they must declare that to the meeting and must not vote on any budget or council tax item. Any member who fails to comply with that requirement will be committing a criminal offence. Can I now ask members to now make their declarations and remind you that you should state the item number and title and the nature of the interest in question. Thank you. Councillor Davis.
Yeah, can I declare a kind of block interest, if I can, for my group in relation to the school's budget, as we are all school governors. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. A petition signed by five
Jerry Eric Ellis.
Thank you.
Three petitions, if I may. I've got two large petitions at the bottom, more prominent. One of them with a 1300 petition.
Thank you.
And the other one with 691. And another petition we can make up to do with the planning application, if I may. And the separate.
Thank you. Councillor Wendy Clements.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I have a signature with 333 signatories opposing the introduction of parking charges on potholes.
Councillor Jeff Green.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I've come to a petition of 262 signatories opposing charges on coastal promenade.
Councillor Bruce Berry.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I have two petitions. First one is 500 signatures of registered actors in the borough. These are against parking charges on the promenade. And the second one is for the same purpose. This is a petition by 1,169 residents who are also opposed to parking charges.
Thank you, Councillor Berry. That's all petitions. Thank you. And moving on to agenda item 6, proposed changes to the Council's budget and policy framework procedure rules. Item 6 at pages 37 to 42 on the Council agenda presents the Cabinet recommendations from the meeting held on the 18th of December for the revision of the Council's budget and policy framework procedure rules, particularly part 3, adoption of plans and strategies, and 4, adoption of the budget. Can I ask the leader and the deputy leader to formally move and second their recommendation, please? Thank you. Is all those in favour of the recommendation, please show. Thank you, that's unanimous. I'm moving on now to agenda item 7, suspension of standing orders of the Council's constitution. As this is Budget Council, the recommendation in respect of the suspension of standing orders 12.1, 12.9 and 12.10 applies. Do I have a proposer and a seconder, please? Thank you. Okay, can I ask all those in favour of the suspension of standing orders of the Council's constitution for this meeting to show? Thank you. Unanimously agreed. We now turn to the Council budget itself and the budget proposals made by the Cabinet on the 19th of February 2018 at pages 43 to 225 of your agenda. I now invite the leader of the Council to formally move the Cabinet's budget resolution as set out in the Council agenda under item 8, noting the revised budget resolution now incorporating the police and the fire authority precepts at item 8, brackets 1, on pages 3 to 16 of the supplementary paper. Can I have that move, please? Thank you. And section. Thank you. So we have before us submissions in respect of the budget from the other two political group leaders. I now invite Councillor Lewis to formally move his budget objection under item 8.2 at pages 17 to 18 of the supplementary paper pack. Councillor Lewis. Thank you. Is there a seconder? Thank you, Councillor Ray. I now invite Councillor Gilchrist to formally propose his budget amendment under item 8.3 at pages 19 to 23 of the supplementary papers pack, as amended by the supplement correction sheet. Councillor Gilchrist.
So moved, Madam Mayor.
Thank you. And is there a second? Thank you, Councillor Harris. So now we move to the budget debate. The Council will now debate the budget resolution on the budget objection and amendment together. I remind members that at the end of the debate, a series of recorded votes, all votes this evening will be recorded, will be required. And I now invite the Leader of the Council to speak to the Cabinet's budget resolution for up to 15 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I rise to speak in favour of the budget agreed by Council. takes every year. Once again, we are meeting to discuss the budget under extremely difficult financial circumstances. Just to repeat the figures, so between 2010 and now, we have had 170 million cut from our budget by Tory government, with another 130 million due to be cut by 2021. Funding cuts of that scale, approaching 40%, mean we have to make extremely difficult decisions. And once again, I'm highlighting the unfairness of the current local government funding system. It cannot be right in any rational world that very affluent authorities like Westminster, for example, receive more generous settlements compared to authorities like Wirral with high levels of deprivation. That cannot be fair in any reasonable sense of play. We also face, we've said this many times, a social care crisis in Wirral and in this country. But local council taxpayers are now being asked by the government to fund a very modest increase in terms of Wirral in social care. And I think that's a real betrayal of local voters. The government, let's be very clear, the government should provide decent, adequate funding for social care out of the national exchequer. It is unreasonable to expect local taxpayers to do that. And it was a scandal, Madam Mayor, that the Chancellor in his autumn statement never even mentioned social care. I think that was shameful. But at long last, I'm pleased to say the government have woken up to how broken our local government funding system is. And they know that if, as we expect at the moment, the revenue support grant is scrapped by 2021, then councils in this country will go bankrupt. And isn't it ironic, Madam Mayor, that the first council in this country that has gone bankrupt for 20 years and had a Section 114 notice is Tory controlled, yes. Not Hampshire County Council. And we know why they're in that position. They've exhausted most of their reserves. They haven't put new income generation proposals in place. They are facing an overspend of 21 million on their budgets, and they have 17 million in reserves. And the government have moved an inspector in to effectively run the council. So I hope that the government, they say they want to do a fair funding review. I hope they're genuine about that. But I fear that unless this broken local government's funding system is fixed, there'll be a lot more Northamptonshires coming down the line. So I really hope that happens. So in terms of the Wirral challenge, we started the year with a 61 million foot savings target. Without doubt, this is the biggest amount we've ever had to save, certainly in my political lifetime. But on social care, I'll repeat it again, we're facing almost a perfect storm. Demand going through the roof and budgets being absolutely decimated. But I'm really pleased to say, as a result of some really hard work by the administration and particularly our cabinet member for children, Bernie Mooney, in terms of dealing with the challenge in children's social care, we will be investing an additional 20 million in that service next year. That is a testimony to the priority this group gives to that particular service. And, we've had some very positive feedback from Ofsted in terms of our improvement journey. I think this extra money will now enable us to quicken that pace of improvement rapidly over the next 12 months and beyond. So I think that's really good news for particularly vulnerable young people in Wirral. And I am totally supportive of the measures we've taken on that. The remainder of our budget proposals for next year reflect continued commitment to deliver our 20 pledges in the Wirral Plan. So, for example, on growing the economy, last week we announced the establishment of the Wirral Growth Company, and Leeds Developments is our preferred partner. The Growth Company will be the vehicle for delivering, I think, the biggest regeneration Wirral has seen, certainly in my political lifetime. I think it's fantastic news for the communities and businesses within Wirral. It will bring together the council's land and assets, and the developer's capital and expertise to inject literally hundreds of millions of pounds of investment into Wirral. It's a new model, it's a new way of working through our joint 50-50 joint venture partnership with Muse. The council will secure an ongoing revenue stream, and that's essential given the cuts that I mentioned, in particularly in our revenue support grant that we are facing. And we'll do this without selling off any public assets and with social goals such as local labour, apprenticeships, local procurement, affordable housing built into contracts from the start. And I think that's a really innovative initiative. Phase one of the growth companies work will focus on five key areas: Birkenhead Town Centre, Seacombe, Bromborough, Bennington, Morton. But we've also insisted that the terrible tragedy in New Ferry that we saw almost exactly a year ago, we will not forget that community. And I think it's shameful that the government have not given any financial assistance for New Ferry. They feel like a forgotten community, and I understand why. But I made the commitments at the launch of the growth company last week that this group will not let New Ferry be left behind. Yeah. And they will be a priority area for the Wirral growth company. And I'm proud of that. I do believe the growth company is a game changer for Wirral. It will leave a lasting legacy for generations to come. And it does show what an innovative council can do by securing new investment in spite of government which continues to be wedded to austerity. So, in terms of other measures in the budget, we'll continue to improve our environments. We'll spend £1.5 million on extending LED lighting. We'll continue our programme of zero tolerance to littering and dog fouling. Some people have said that we're too heavy-handed on little acts. I respectfully disagree. On housing, we're going to extend the selective licensing system to cover some new areas to tackle the issue of landlords in the private sector. And I'm really proud that last week at Cabinet, we announced that we will invest in 500 new apartments on a major brownfield site on Wirral Waters. Not only will this be a catalyst for other projects on Wirral Waters, but by building on a major brownfield site, that will relieve pressure on our precious green belts. And I'm proud that this Labour group has announced that. One of our key pledges, Madam Mayor, from the start has been a zero tolerance to domestic abuse. And I'm really pleased that in the budget of next year, we'll be investing in supporting the Freedom Programme, which provides vital help for victims of domestic abuse. I'm proud that we're putting money into that. And on parking charges, we've just seen a number of petitions from members opposite to the introduction of charges for parking at new locations. I say to the opposition, if you feel so strongly about this announcement, why don't you lobby your government and get them to restore the millions and millions that we've lost in our budget? And we need to do this. So that would be a positive contribution that you could make. Finally, Madam Mayor, I want to say a few words about what I think is this council's most important resource, our staff. I want to just take this opportunity in moving our budget to thank our staff. You know, they give fantastic service for the people of Wirral, day in, day out, and under sometimes very difficult circumstances. Over the past few years, as we know, staff have suffered as a result of the government's decision to effectively freeze their pay. And this has resulted in wages of local government employees and other public sector workers falling behind living standards. I believe the time has come to address this issue. Therefore, for 2018-19, we're announcing that we will propose that we agree the national pay offer at 2% plus an additional 1%, giving a total pay increase for our staff of 3%. This will be a challenge, it will cost us an extra million, but it's the right thing to do for a fantastic job that our staff do on behalf of every resident. Madam Mayor, to council tax levels for 18-19, we are, and I say it's reluctant, we are reluctantly proposing an increase of 5.99%, including 3% preset for social care. Sadly, due to the scale of the cuts that we're facing from the government, I believe we have little choice. I am, however, pleased that this administration has recognised the particular challenges faced by care leavers, and from 2018-19, we're announcing that this group will be exempt from paying council tax. Care Leavers face huge financial challenges, and I think it's right that we make this announcement tonight, and I'm proud again of this group. So, Madam Mayor, to sum up, I'm proud that Labour is delivering a balanced budget in the teeth of certainly the most draconian cuts I've ever seen from this Tory government, and that we're doing this in line with our principles of fairness and social justice. The proposals I've set out invest in our key priorities, in keeping vulnerable children safe, growing the economy, protecting our environment. And in closing, I just want to say this. I sincerely hope that the government will listen to those, actually many of whom in their own party, who say that local government finance is no longer sustainable. The system is broken and needs a radical overhaul. The government urgently needs to restore fairness to the way funding is distributed and reconsider withdrawing the revenue support grant. Let us hope, Madam Mayor, that events in Northamptonshire provide a salutary lesson to ministers. Finally, Madam Mayor, I take this opportunity to thank members of the public who replied to our budget consultation. Can I thank members of Overview and Scrutiny Committees who considered budget options at meetings earlier in the year? And can I thank members of my group? Can I particularly thank Jeanette Williamson, Cabinet Member for Finance, who worked tirelessly to ensure that we delivered the legal budget while continuing to provide good quality frontline services for our residents. Madam Mayor, I'm proud of this budget. I so move.
Demonstrates how high needs funding is to be allocated, but highlights that whilst the increase supports current commitments, it does not provide funding to support priorities. 0.5% top slice of £1 million of the school's budget is recommended to support the funding of the high needs review. The details of this review will come to council, I think it's the 27th of March, so we will report back on that when that comes along. The base rate for early years providers will increase next year from £3.60 per child to £3.68, and there's no other changes in this area. Pressures continue on the school's budget, and a 2% pay award for teachers and non-teachers is anticipated, together with an increase in non-teaching pension costs. Schools and their governors, and we're all governors, so we've all had to sit down and look at these budgets. Schools and school budgets continue to make careful plans and strategies, which together with the revised spending decisions will aim to keep the budgets within the amounts available. Now, I've had hundreds of letters, and I think we've all had hundreds of letters from the Deaf Society who are really concerned about some of the things that are going on in this budget. I've already given a commitment in Cabinet that there will be no changes to the services that are provided to children with essential services. There's no money coming out of that budget, it will stay the same. And the local authority is not proposing to reduce the current budget allocation and is committed to maintain the high standards of support to children and schools to ensure that their needs are both met and that we give them the support and the advice that they require. The local authority currently provides a budget allocation of £1,022,700 to the sensory services for the high needs block, and there's absolutely no proposals to change that. The key purpose of this proposal is to that we treat all children in the SEND element exactly the same. All children will be treated equally. There's no changes. Deaf children and children in partially sighted will see no reduction in their services. But what I have done is I've asked if any parent sees a reduction in service to their child to come forward straight away, that will be addressed. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Mooney. We now move to the budget objection as proposed by the Conservative Group. Councillor Mooney, you now have 15 minutes to speak to your budget objection. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Before I begin, in terms of the Conservative Group's objection to this budget, can I ask, firstly, that I'm pleased to hear from the Cabinet Member for Children's Services that she has addressed the concerns that have been outlined to her by parents and carers on behalf of the National Deaf Children's Society, and could I ask her if she would be willing to meet with me and those parents to put their fears at rest, because there is genuine fear that when those budgets are passported down to schools, or the responsibilities rather, that some of that attention will be lost. I have offered to meet with some of the parents. It may be useful if the Cabinet Member was there as well, if she wants to. She can invite them later if that's something she wants to do. Madam Mayor, if we look at the budget that the Leader of the Council has presented to us this evening, we put it in the context of next month's rise in the national living wage to £7.83 an hour. We put it in the context of the biggest increase in the basic state pension to 125.95 pence per week. The new basic state pension rises next month to £164, and the tax-free allowance next month also rises to £11,850, more than double what it was when we inherited the economy from the previous Labour government. All these people, Madam Mayor, were looking forward to a boost in their incomes next month, will instead now be receiving higher council tax demands from their Labour council. Amazingly, every budget Labour presents, Madam Mayor, is always within a smidgen of the limit to avoid the ultimate test of a referendum on council tax increases. Proof, Madam Mayor, that the Labour Group starts from the position of what they can get away with as opposed to what they need. The Labour Group, Madam Mayor, I understand in their private meetings, did not vote unanimously for this budget. Madam Mayor, if members of the Labour Group abstained on their vote, why should the rest of us vote for their budget?
But we didn't. Madam Mayor, we have, if you look at the cost of the authority, we have a chief officer team that now costs this council £1.4 million a year. And that's before we've included the bumper children goodbyes. The poor souls that are running this council, the underpaid directors, need the additional support of £2.6 million worth of consultants. And what do we get for that, Madam Mayor? We get reports that are never published, written by people who are never here, about services they never receive. We look at the car parking charges, Madam Mayor, and we've had a number of petitions presented already this evening by members of the Conservative Group. The charges that have been introduced already by the Labour Group into our country parks are killing off visitors to those areas, and the businesses within those country parks are suffering already. And now the Cabinet wants to do the same for our magnificent coastal areas. This, Madam Mayor, is to raise £150,000 from people who have the simple pleasure of visiting our promenades and coastal areas. Thanks to this proposal, Madam Mayor, many of them will not be able to set foot outside of their cars. And what are the fees from this going to be spent on, Madam Mayor? £150,000 from parking charges, coincidentally, covers the cost of their failing, hopeless newspaper, The Rural View. Madam Mayor, this is a newspaper that half the borough doesn't receive and that the other half doesn't want. A newspaper that last month extolled the virtues of our coastal areas. The hypocrisy and the double standards from the group opposite, Madam Mayor, are reaching new depths. At the last meeting of the council, we called on Councillor Davis to sit down with the organisers of a 5,000 name petition against his plans, but he refused. Indeed, Madam Mayor, we have a Labour leader who paid little attention to his party and too much attention to the shadowy advisers and consultants that he surrounds himself with. To many of us, Madam Mayor, the real talent and ability in the Labour group is now to be found outside the Cabinet, and some would say it is to be found outside the group. To be fair, he is not the only Labour leader to find himself isolated, exposed and on the defensive. Claire Cover in Haringey can probably sympathise with the position that he now finds himself in. Madam Mayor, it would be a miracle if the Labour group were to accept our very reasonable arguments as to why this budget should be sent back to the Cabinet for reconsideration. However, Madam Mayor, as they have ignored the parents of Lindale School to close that school, as they have ignored, I'm sorry for boring you, but you know, the parents of Lindale School would disagree, equally the carers at Girtle Court that you closed, so we have no expectation that the Labour group is about to listen to the Conservative group now, Madam Mayor. Councillor Davis talked about his pride in the increase in the salaries for council staff. And there's some very interesting figures that he's forgotten to tell us about tonight, Madam Mayor. In 2011-12, when he became leader of this council, the lowest paid member of staff in this authority was paid the full-time equivalent of just over £12,000. This year, that pay has gone up to £15,800, a rise of £3,700 over the last 6 years. Madam Mayor, at the same time, the highest paid member of this authority, who in 2011-12 was paid £131,000, now takes home £178,000, a pay rise of £46,000. Madam Mayor, this is a Labour council in practice. The highest paid person in this council in 2011-12 received just under 11 times the lowest paid member of this authority. Now, after 6 years of Labour control, that differential has increased to over 11 times the salary of the lowest paid member of staff. Madam Mayor, that is the legacy of 7 years of Labour control of this authority.
The budget and the Local Government Association. have a copy of the first magazine that was sent to all councillors last autumn with that nice smiling picture of the Chancellor of the Exchequer on. But alongside it was a quote from Lord Porter of the Local Government Association, who said, "It is hugely disappointing that the budget offered nothing to ease the financial crisis facing local services." And as you know, the Local Government Association do a briefing for councillors, if anyone would wish to read it, about the deep difficulties with the budget over the years. The on-the-day briefing explained how tough things were, but also highlighted some of the changes the Local Government Association hoped to see. Some of those changes came in dribs and drabs towards the end of the budget process, and the recent budget setting process, where some money was found towards social care at the last minute. It's very difficult for anyone to plan ahead when we hear things at the last minute. I was reading the other day one of John McDonald's speeches. This hasn't been a conversion on the road to Southampton or wherever it was, but it was a reminder that he pointed out, and it was useful to have this pointed out, the government said the deficit was supposed to be eradicated in 2015, then it was 2016, then it was 2017, then it was 2020, then it might be 2025. So the forecasts are never right. One forecast that we have been following very carefully is that of the crisis in care of the elderly, because the Local Government Association have described it in their bulletin on the briefing last year on the budget as close to the brink. It's thanks again to the determination of staff who work in the care of the elderly, who have now received in minimum wages, that the service continues rather than collapses. But I want to sound some warnings about the budget as well. First of all, as far as I can see, the council's sailing really close to the wind. It is actually barely ready for room for manoeuvre, barely any room for manoeuvre, and I'll come on to that. If I was, John Hale isn't here, but I've never sailed a boat, so excuse me, the waters are very choppy. There are more storms coming, and some of these are Royal's making, some of them are the government's making. But we're asking local people to pay more when their pay and prospects are uncertain. Some of those pay and prospects are uncertain because of Brexit. And if that shadow is removed, then there might be some more stability. But I'll come back to that. The budget we've got assumes over £20 million in one-offs. It includes £4 million from the predicted year-end general fund balances, which have been swept into the current year's budget. The 1.3 million underspend on the current year has gone into supporting the budget. And of course there's a significant shift of money from reserves and provisions. Each year I look at the reserves and provisions, and I can say that the council has been using those carefully and gradually, and there are some left. There has been some criticism about loans to other councils. My criticism of that is, whilst we've got some money, we need to try and get some interest on it to help our cash flow. Well, some of those interest rates strike me as particularly low, and I have had explanations, but we lent a district council, a Conservative controlled district council, £5 million, and it gives us 0.45% interest. Now, I rather hope that our Treasury management will, just in the next round of any money we can get interest from, get a bit more. I want to want to talk about some of the issues before us. I read just in the last day or so some comments about Birkenhead Market. I found a wonderful picture of Birkenhead Market under construction. I think I was one of the members of the council at the time that remembers the disputes in the 70s about the construction of the new precinct. So I have this beautiful picture of the market under construction, and it really took me aback. But I've seen in the press recently some criticism of consultation with traders regarding the market, and if we are to make success of transforming Birkenhead, I hope that those consultations are successful and people actually take them along with us rather than left fuming. One group of people left fuming, of course, is those who now have to pay for parking in the country parks. The income was at one time going to be, what was it, looking at 2017's report, we were going to get £250,000 a year, and we were going to get £400,000 if it was a £4 a day charge. Fortunately, the council saw some of the objections and did reduce it. But I understand, because I've listened to where the petitions came from. that I think about the inconvenience that people who might want to get on the front of West Cairn and the amount of battery parking that will take place. I have to say that our visitors are not cash cows to be milked. I looked at what was expected to come out of this year's income, and I looked at what was spent. You see, we spent £9,281 on parking meters for Eastern Country Park. And therefore, it's not surprising when I read a local statement from some of the local party. When I said that Wirral was entering choppy waters, I didn't realise that some of the crew were already mutinying. See, the crew at the far end of the borough, writing the Eastern Labour leaflets, have said that Wirral Council may need to rethink here. We say restore free parking to the Eastern Country Park. So it appears to me that there appear to be some mutinous crew members amongst this happy family. I want to turn to a few other issues. I'm still making up my mind about the wisdom of all aspects of the Roman country. See, I remember 2001, when Gordon Brown lent money. We went for PFI, we got our fingers burned. We were told it was the only money around, it was the only show. We've been through the World Waters issue. I've got this wonderful picture of a photograph of Wirral Waters with what Wirral family on the map. But the quote is from Stella Shue, who refers to Peel International Trade Centre. Well, occasionally, things don't work out. What I'm anxious about is how will things work out if things don't work out? You get the message. I also want to criticise in this budget the interims. I want to be tough on interims, on the causes of interims, if you forgive that pun. I want to be tough, too, on Wirral Field, because it invited people to take part in the government budget consultation, and in my area, it was delivered after the consultation closed through one of the chiefs. And we spent £30,000 on a